Well, it's Tuesday again, but it's Tuesday, February 7th, and there's nothing really super going on right now.
We do have an overflowing bowl of news for you today.
Oh, we're just awful. Just terrible. I don't even, why is this happening? Well, I mean, first off, you know, welcome back. We did some videos. We got a update on our MSI giveaway coming up soon. We're going to post the video, so be on the lookout for that. It's going to be pretty standard issue stuff. We've got a nice set of kit from Fractal Design that we've added to the pot. So we've got the Toshiba RD400 NVMe SSD, MSI graphics and motherboard. It's going to be a nice Kaby Lake system, so that's going to be a lot of fun. And yeah, on with the news, I guess.
Well, there's been a lot in the news about immigrants. Now we're not gonna opine on that very much, but there is an
sorry rest of world.
yeah sorry Team Red or Team Blue, we're not getting involved, but there is an interesting technological aspect of the whole immigration thing.
U.S. border agents are checking Facebook profiles.
What? Facebook profiles. So if you are caught in this dragnet of people who are out of the country and trying to get back in, they want to look at your Facebook profile to determine if you are radicalized or have shown any sort of extreme views.
Mm. I can think of any number of dystopian science fiction novels that feature this type of thing as like a key fixture in the story.
Well, see, here's my worry. More and more, like we saw the Chinese story where they're using social media to determine your credit score.
Oh, yeah, the gamification of social media.
And now we're seeing this. I don't have a Facebook profile. But who's going to believe me? Am I just going to be a non-citizen at some point because I don't participate on Facebook?
How great is it going to be if, like, those places that you go to get a fake identity and it's like, here's your green card or here's your visa, here's your fake Facebook profile. It goes back 20 years.
We should start farming Facebook profiles right now so we can sell them in 10 years.
That's going to be a gold mine in just a few years. It's going to be, I mean... What other time in history people selling refugee papers? I don't know. Never mind. Moving right along. In a surprising turn of events, there's been a court ruling that says Google, unlike Microsoft, has to turn over emails stored on foreign servers.
Yeah, there was a previous ruling that Microsoft didn't have to do this, but now they've changed their mind and they're saying it does not. What was the phrase that they used? It was. Possessory interest. I've never heard of that before. But it does not violate your possessory interest if they get your mail from a foreign server and read it.
As long as it doesn't deprive you of your email.
Right,
is the reasoning. Now, I would really like to know where this legal team was during like the Jamie Thomas RIAA things. Because if they're saying that for this, then they can't be saying that copyright infringement is theft either. And so all these, you know, multi-million dollar judgments that the copyright cartels have gotten against individual citizens would seem to no longer apply based on this legal reasoning.
Yeah, to say that making a copy of something doesn't affect the ownership of it, I mean, that pretty much excuses all piracy, right?
The other argument here was that because the emails were going to be reviewed in the U.S., that meant that they were subject to U.S. jurisdiction, which is really, like... I don't know. That's the mental gymnastics involved in getting to that conclusion.
After we steal this car, we're going to ship it overseas to a country that doesn't have these laws, so it's fine.
I mean, really, the mind reels here. Now, the really surprising thing is that when Microsoft went through this, the situation was very similar, but a little different. It was email stored in Europe, I think. And so, you know, the European Union was looking at this and it's like, you know, this is not a good situation in terms of privacy and customer data and that sort of thing. And Microsoft did not have to turn over that data ultimately. And that went all the way to the federal level. So this is a developing story. And I think that we're going to see a lot more of this in future follow-ups and that kind of thing. But I think that Google will probably fight this tooth and nail because it undermines their business interests abroad.
Oh, they've announced that they will appeal it however possible. But you got to wonder how far that'll go.
Yeah. It's like, well, we didn't really take people's email because it doesn't deprive them of their email. And it's like, how far do you want to take that argument? I mean, you can take that argument as far as you want. It's great. It's like,
yeah, well, with anything digital.
We didn't install a rootkit and Trojan on their home computer because it didn't deprive them of access to their home computer. So that's totally fine. What?
I can see that argument being made.
2K, they make a basketball game, apparently. I'm not really into sports. So.
I think all sports games can do this.
So this is reading your biometric face data. So some players apparently did this and had their biometric face data go into the game. And then they were like, wait a minute, what does 2K do with that data? And so they sued 2K and lost.
Yeah, it turns out that much like Facebook, once you submit something to these video games, it becomes their property. So your face is their property now.
Would you say that 2K has a literal book of three-dimensional faces?
I bet they take those faces and populate like the crowd and stuff in future games. Because that would be really realistic.
Yeah. But this is probably bad for, you know, your face is being used as an authentication mechanism for right. some types of things. So like Windows Hello, which some notebooks are equipped with, is a kind of, you know, facial recognition thing that's better than a webcam, theoretically. Or like the Windows, Intel's like 3D Sense, whatever it is, that tries to make a 3D picture of your face. So depending on how the information is stored and how detailed it is, this type of biometric data may no longer be a good type of user security, because it's going to get to the point where pretty much all companies have a lot of your biometric data.
Well, think about this sort of scenario. Well, so the Super Bowl, that's this week. We don't care about it, but it happened. Facial recognition all over the place there. You can't get inside that arena without going through facial recognition. Also, these protests and riots, they're using facial recognition.
Oh, in the crowds, yeah.
So if I have the means with like 3D printing or whatever to reproduce your biometric face and I hack 2K, I can now have an unlimited number of masks that are actual humans.
Neat. That sounds like what people would need to maintain their liberty and security in the future.
It's like we could share them. There could be a face sharing application. It'd be like Tor for faces.
We should call it Friend Face. I don't know. No, it's just not really good.
But biometrics. Now this next story is it's interesting. It's sort of it was a good use in this situation. I don't know about a good use. It was a good outcome, but very dystopian. So a man filed for home insurance. His house burned down. He made a 911 call. My house is on fire. I'm freaking out. And they found some weirdness about how the fire started. The fire investigators, they have amazing techniques. They figured out something isn't right here. So the cops actually went to his pacemaker data, looked at his heart rate, and determined that he was not alarmed at any time during all of this going down.
Huh. That seems really weird. It seems really weird even as an arsonist that you wouldn't be alarmed, especially because like he was in the fire and throwing his stuff out and that kind of thing.
I don't know what the details were. He probably was just outside.
Like, I tossed all my stuff outside. It was really crazy.
But it is. I mean, that's nerves of steel that you set your house on fire and you're just like total normal heart rate while you call it into 911. I think I would be a little apprehensive trying to get away with that. Maybe it wasn't his first rodeo. You
know? His cat also died, which is really surprising.
It's brutal, man, to murder your cat just to prove.
It's now the really interesting thing here, the thing that set off alarm bells. I mean, I didn't follow the case. He's been charged. It hasn't gone to court. You know, we don't know. It's like the person that wrote the article, it kind of at first seemed like, you know, this is kind of Orwellian, using your pacemaker data against you and that kind of thing. But there was an incident that happened in my hometown that the arson investigators investigated this fire, and the thing that they were hung up on was that there were multiple points of origin of the fire. And like this story, the pet had died, you know, in the fire. And it was the person was really suspect for like a year or two until they finally figured out what happened. And what happened in that case was that the cat had gotten into something flammable. So, and I hate to be laughing at this. It's really terrible. I shouldn't be laughing at this. But the cat set itself on fire somehow and was running around the house, setting the curtains and couches and stuff on fire because it was freaking out.
I could see like rubbing against things to try and stop. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And so the guy's house burned down. And I feel really bad for the guy because he was under investigation for like a year or 18 months because they were sure that he had burned his house down. But he had a really good alibi. But it was like, you know, how did you do this? There's multiple points of origin. Well, the cat, they figured out it was the cat eventually, but it took forever.
Now, this is interesting in terms of like how hard is it to get this data, right? Does this take a warrant? It's medical data. But like, what if the wife has a pacemaker and the husband is a cop and he suspects her of cheating? So he wants to know how her heart rate was on Tuesday.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Is this Fifth Amendment territory where you can't...
Your heart can't testify against you.
This could be really bad, you know, in a future where you can just do a direct brain scan and it's like, well, it's the Fifth Amendment, but it's, you know, your brain's giving up electromagnetic signatures for, you know, whatever. It's just...
Yeah, it does seem like we're moving more and more toward a zero privacy society. Yeah. I don't know how we stop that.
I just doesn't seem like that's a good idea. It doesn't seem like the human condition is ready for that yet.
Well, I think this is our third week of Patch of the Week. It seems inevitable that every week we're going to have one to tell you about.
And this one reads like it's from 1998, but it's not. There's a Windows denial of service 0 day. And so this is something that can crash your computer and cause a blue screen just from a simple network connection on SMB. SMB is like the file sharing sort of interface protocol on Windows. And this was a notoriously buggy service, especially in the late 90s and early 2000s. And yeah, it's shown up again. And it can denial of service your machine, cause services to crash, and even a blue screen. So that's great.
Ironically, this is only the latest version. It only affects Windows 8 and after. So the earlier ones are okay.
Nice. So be sure to patch your machines. You guys are behind a good firewall, right? With several layers of protection and all kinds of other stuff, because
you can turn SMB off to protect against this. So if you're getting like multiple blue screens, you can't figure out why, maybe try turning off SMB.
That'd probably be good. Well, ransomware has completely shut down an Ohio town. This is sort of a follow-up from last week. Licking County.
I wonder if Licking County, they make any jokes in that local paper. So yeah, we talked about last week. It was a hotel, DC, and a police station. So now a whole county has been shut down there. Pretty much everything that they have, every computer was infected. It was, they don't know exactly where it originated, but they suspect just some low-level employee got like a phishing attack or something.
Yep.
And immediately everything was taken down.
Well, in America, we've got a new head of the FCC, who's, it's the Federal Communications Commission. He's doing some stuff.
He's not a fan of net neutrality.
Yeah.
And when I say not a fan, he seems to be dedicated to killing it with fire.
And so the particular thing in the news this week, well, the thing that we're starting with is zero rating. So what zero rating is let's suppose that AT&T offers a streaming television service like Netflix, and your program that you want to watch is available on AT&T. Well, if you subscribe to AT&T service, which let's say is $10 a month, you can watch all the unlimited TV shows that you want through AT&T streaming service. So this is over your cell phone, you know, DSL, whatever we're talking about. For this example, let's assume that we're talking about a wireless service like wireless 4G. Now, if you were to watch that same television show on Netflix, you would pay the Netflix subscription fee, you know, less than $10. But you would pay a data fee as well to AT&T. And so, you know, in order to receive that show, let's say that you were on the 5 gigabyte plan and you were, you know, you were watching 20 gigabytes of TV shows. And so if you were on AT&T's plan, you would not pay for 20 gigabytes of data. But if you're on Netflix's plan, you would pay Netflix as well as AT&T for the data.
Now, opponents of this, proponents of net neutrality, argue that if data costs you money as an ISP and you're setting a price on that, how can you suddenly say that it doesn't have that price as long as they're watching your stuff? Because you're still moving data. I mean,
yeah.
Physically, it's no different. It still has to do the same thing.
Yeah, and this is, it's really, you know, the data really comes in two components. It's one where the ISP's network hits the internet. It's like you have a company in your area that provides internet access. You know, AT&T is not the internet. They've got to get the internet from somebody. And then the other part is sort of collectively referred to as like last mile infrastructure. It's like, oh, it's the last mile. So you got to really pay attention to these arguments. And maybe the new FCC director just doesn't understand the technology. I mean, I would think that he's not being deliberately malicious, maybe wrong. But, you know, Wheeler came around. You know, Wheeler was a lobbyist. Kind of came around. I mean, maybe he did. I don't know. But if you look at the technology, those two halves, they're always arguing the opposite thing. And so in this case, they're saying, oh, the last mile is not the problem. It's the connection to the internet. And so you know, that doesn't seem like, especially with wireless, like wireless 4G, that doesn't seem like that would make sense because, you know, if your whole subscriber base is trying to make a phone call, it's not going to work. Look at like when a tornado goes through an area, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't affect the cell towers or there's flooding or something like that. The cell towers are not really affected, but everybody trying to make a call, just a simple phone call, which does not involve a lot of data, will saturate and clog the cellular infrastructure. You can't make a call. That seems to me to be a last mile problem. And so if you have everybody in your subscriber base that's trying to watch a television show through 4G, and I don't think that, I think that's going to work about as well as in those emergency situations when you can't make a call because something's happening because everybody's trying to make a call at once. It's just not going to work. And so, yeah, that probably is a last mile problem. And so zero rating that data would seem to say, we don't think that we're going to have a last mile problem getting out all of this data to all these people that might want to watch TV shows. It's like, okay, great. Rate your data the same as everybody else's data. That's competition. That's a level playing field for competition. And that would seem not to be the case here.
Now, Wheeler, you mentioned Wheeler. What Wheeler did on his way out that made everybody say, oh, maybe he wasn't the devil, is he started probes into AT&T and T-Mobile and Verizon. Was that the other one?
Yeah.
It was three companies. And the probes were looking into what we're talking about here. It's like, how can you make this argument? It doesn't make any sense. And what the new guy's done, Ajit Pai, is that his name?
I think so. Pronunciation, we're probably not getting right.
Yeah. What he has done is just ended those probes without really any explanation.
Ah, you guys are doing fine. You know, you guys, right. It's AT&T, you're a big company. You know, you're amazing. You're doing, you know, you're doing God's work here, giving data to the people. It's going to be great. And he said that a big part of this is also bringing internet access to the poor, and that, you know, poor people really like being able to stream TV over their 4G connection without having to pay extra for data because data costs money. And so there's a follow-up article from Gizmodo that's like, okay, you want to give data to the poor. He actually started working against programs that help subsidize internet connections for the poor through a program that used to provide subsidized telephone connections for the poor. That was something else that Wheeler opened up and was like, well, we're giving phone lines to the poor. We're giving people like a $10 a month subsidy if you qualify for phone lines. Why don't we make that apply to internet as well? And so he's wanting to roll that back as well.
Now, a cynic might say that Wheeler did all this knowing that whoever came in behind him was going to tear it down. So it was sort of like, you know, let the people have their hope. But no, none of this will ever happen.
Yeah, it's really surprising and disappointing and just completely wrong. And Australia, Telstra, is rolling out an incredibly fast gigabit LTE network. And so again, this is an interesting situation because this is a wireless provider there. And the copper infrastructure in Australia is perhaps worse than the copper infrastructure in America. It is appallingly bad. It has been chronically mismanaged, in my opinion, for the last 20 years to the point of ruination. And so the companies that are involved in providing broadband to the masses want nothing more than to have no real physical infrastructure to speak of to manage. I mean, I have never in my life seen so much belly aching over just run the fiber optic cable that is 100-year infrastructure and be done with it. But these companies cannot be bothered to do that.
Even though in a lot of, I don't know about Australia and America, they're taking subsidies for years.
Yeah.
Years and years taking subsidies to build this infrastructure and just never doing it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really disappointing. And so this would also seem to be an argument against, you know, last mile connectivity being any kind of a problem because they've teamed up with Netgear. And they're rolling this out, and they're rolling out these little pocket routers that will do something like, you know, it'll connect up to 20 devices or 60 devices or something like that with your, you know, 4G LTE connection. But I can tell you right now that gigabit thing, it ain't happening. LTE is great because it lets each device have its own little slice of the spectrum. But for those kind of densities, you're going to need to roll out tons and tons of towers and tons of connectivity. And I just don't see this being good enough for anything other than, you know, basic residential service long term.
Not to mention the inherent latency of the mobile. But so wait, you're saying that ISPs are lying about connection speeds?
Well, that's a great lead in for our next story. New York is suing the crap out of Charter and Time Warner.
So in New York, they advertised connections at speeds that were just not possible based on the infrastructure. It was never going to happen.
Yeah, they were lying through their teeth, apparently. if you read it and you would, you know, if what the Attorney General is saying is to be believed.
So what I like about this case is what they're seeking. Usually in one of these cases, it's like a class action and, you know, they're going to send you a check for $2. It's like, give them $2, give the government $500 million and everything's fine. But they made $1 billion on the lies.
Yeah.
But this, the legal language, they say full restitution, which would be pretty severe.
Yeah. So this is maybe the Attorney General angling to actually get reasonable infrastructure in New York. New York City is very surprising. The first time like that I went there and I got to like deal with sort of the underbelly of some of the infrastructure, I was like, this city is going to be state of the art. They're going to be doing stuff right. Everything's going to be organized. Everything, you know, everybody's going to be riding the light on fiber optics. No. New York City is a microcosm of corruption and dysfunction when it comes to bandwidth and how it's deployed and little competing fiefdoms. Like you can literally, it's like you can go down a city block and have four different ISPs that have been competing with each other tooth and nail, and they absolutely will not allow anybody else into the building or into the connection or right of way. And that's just how it is. And it's terrible. It's so dysfunctional.
And also with the, you know, the vertical landscape there, mobile is not the kind, like doing that, what you would do in Australia, yeah. You're never going to do it in New York.
It's like, oh, I took two steps to the left. I'm in the shadow of a giant concrete and steel building. It's not going to, you got nothing. I mean, you can't even maintain a phone call. A phone call. Think about this. A phone call is 64 kilobit. Maybe not even that. 64 kilobit. It's nothing in terms of like a data connection. And you struggle to maintain a voice connection just going about your daily life in New York City. Not just because of the population density, but because the infrastructure sucks. So, yeah. And you would expect New York City to not have that problem because New York City, you know, it's one of the pinnacles of human achievement or whatever. I don't know. No, it's not. Terrible.
So we talked about Netflix, AT&T. Everybody wants their own media distribution right now.
Yep.
You know, Amazon.
He who controls the spice.
Exactly. Yeah, they're finding out that, you know, the success of Netflix sort of took them all by surprise, and the failure of the dinosaur TV commercial-led media, it just isn't working. So everybody wants their own media distribution. And well, Google has now, there used to be an optional DRM in Chrome. Well, it's not optional anymore.
And this is, I see this largely as a move by Google to remain competitive with companies that are providing hardware like Chromecast for doing television. Because a lot of people have a surprising number of people have been willing to shell out real dollars for devices like Roku and Chromecast to bring them their television, to the point that Comcast, you know, they were offering free, if you were a Comcast customer, you could get, you know, free cable streaming on a Roku device. They're going to charge for that now is one of the things. And I think
HBO does that as well.
Yeah. And I think Google is sort of seeing, it's like, you know, we want eyeball time on devices. Any data that we get from somebody using their device, from interacting with their device, whatever that is in all forms of media, we want a piece of that. And so Google doing this DRM thing is really just making sure that Google is still relevant in terms of having your on time. Google wants to be in front of your eyes as many hours a day as possible in all forms. And now, that's what this is.
One of the problems here is with the laws that we have about DRM and copyright, you cannot audit that browser anymore without risking breaking the law because any sort of way of bypassing DRM or even looking at it is now illegal.
Yeah, it's really an unfortunate situation in America. There are some narrow exceptions, but the whole like turning anybody who's doing any kind of real research into DRM or anybody who even just speaks up and says, hey, you know, DRM is kind of inconvenient and may deny legit right holders access to stuff that they've paid for is basically treated like a pariah, if not by, you know, normal people, normies, if not treated that way by normies, then certainly the legal community, it's like, you know, a company wants to bring a case against you and it's like, oh, this nerd in the basement just, you know, doesn't believe in capitalism, doesn't want to, you know, would like to see us not make money on this kind of thing. And it's like, no, it's just, it's not like that at all. So,
and like we talk about with a lot of these kinds of cases, just imagine whatever experience you've had with judges, think about trying to explain the EME to a judge and the other side, the table next to you is Google lawyers. How do you think that's going to go for you?
I just wanted to make a copy of my movies, Judge. I paid for it. I didn't want it to disappear. Like, you know, I signed up for that one artist streaming service and it went away and I didn't want to, you know, repeat that again. So Windows DRM files may also betray you if you use Tor. This is sort of an interesting situation.
Yeah, this is the WebM format. Because of what the DRM does to negotiate and see if you're the holder of this thing.
If you're legit.
It's going to step outside of Tor. So if you're in a browser and you click a WebM link, whether you know that's what it is or not, it's going to talk to Microsoft.
Potentially.
And that's going to happen outside of your browser.
Yep.
So that is going to betray your IP address.
Yeah. So when it loads the file, it's a function of the operating system to determine if you're licensed to view that content. But a specially crafted file can make sure that request basically makes it back to law enforcement or makes it back to whoever. And that communication mechanism is outside the Tor communication mechanism by default. So you should be aware of that. That's sort of kind of dangerous.
Now, you should always combo Tor with a VPN. And you should set your VPN at the router level. Now, if you don't know how to do that...
We've got a video coming up. You should also use a real operating system. Like if the the things that you're doing really require Tor, Windows is probably not a good choice for the operating system. What with its keyloggers and botnets and whatever. And also this happened. There's a new release of OPN Sense, which is the fork of PF Sense, and I'm really excited to take a look at this. We sort of love PF Sense here, and our upcoming video is going to be on an upgrade to the video that we did previously on PF Sense. This is OPN Sense, and so I really want to take a look at this and see how it stacks up against PF Sense with this new release. So, just a quick mention. Well, a hacker has just left 150,000 printers owned.
This is, I guess you really can't think of printers as Internet of Things. But much like the IP cameras that are unprotected, a lot of people just plug in their printer and walk away. And if it has the Internet Printing Protocol, it's probably open and people can get to it from the Internet.
So terrible.
This guy is actually a nice guy. All he did was print one page, not solid black, just printed one page that was like, hey, your printer's on the internet, it's unsecured, you should probably do something about this. Now, there was a previous version of this where they printed Nazi propaganda.
Of course.
So if you've got a printer, find out if it's got the IPP protocol and put a password on it.
Well, the other big news this week is... ZeniMax won their lawsuit against Oculus Rift.
$500 million. Now, of course, Facebook can probably afford that. But it is interesting how devastating it can be if they find out you're using somebody else's code.
This is a really, like, we can talk about this one for a little bit because, they didn't actually release the code. And actually, the people involved are Lucky Palmer, I think that's his name, and John Carmack.
Of Doom fame.
Yeah, John Carmack of the Doom. Now, if you're not familiar with John Carmack, he's a fantastically gifted programmer, responsible for a lot of the engine and engineering in the original Doom, and really a lot of the engineering that built id Software, you know, Wolfenstein 3D and all their stuff.
First-person shooters, you could say that he's, you know, probably like one of the parents of that. Yes.
And if you want to learn more about his character and who he is, there's a really great book called Masters of Doom. You should totally read that, take a look at that book, because it's about the early history of id Software, and not just Carmack, but also Romero and those other guys. And so it's a really amazing, fascinating book. But his commentary from this is really interesting. So ZeniMax bought id Software, where Carmack was, and Facebook sort of poached him from id Software after the buyout. And so... VR was sort of Carmack's baby. Carmack literally is it's not rocket science. He does rocket science as kind of a hobby. So, and you know, ZeniMax was like, whoa, 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 this is our guy. Like, this is the guy. This is the lead guy. You know, there's got to be a non-disclosure agreement. There's got to be, you know, some stuff here. And so from an engineering perspective and from a whole bunch of other perspectives, ZeniMax won. But I don't know that they really won because they were asking for $6 billion, but they only have to pay $500 million.
And it's unlikely that he might have brought some stuff over that he had from before, but it's probably not true that he had to.
Yeah.
So it's a rough argument. Again, I bet this in a lot of ways has to do with the judge sitting there that has no concept of what any of this means and just took a stab in the dark.
Well, I think that it was probably a masterstroke on ZeniMax's lawyer's part to not release the code, because I think Carmack probably is right, because Carmack said, look, if you release this code on the internet that we're arguing about, you would be ridiculed for this being sort of nonsensical. And the expert did seem to say that the code in question was different, and so it's a different implementation. And so we have this, it's kind of unprecedented that we have, you know, a different implementation of various functions, and both sides are saying, yes, this is a different implementation of these two things, but it's similar enough that we're going to say, okay, there's been a violation here. So $200 million, I think, for violation of a non-disclosure agreement for Palmer Luckey as well, which is, that's a pretty substantial sum for violation of a non-disclosure agreement. Jesus.
Now, of course, we are talking about possibly a huge industry coming up.
Yeah, yeah. And it seems like Oculus is doing well. I mean, they're doing better than I would have expected. So, you know, that plus poaching Carmack, I really don't see $500 million as that big of a judgment.
I saw a statistic, that new Resident Evil game, 10% are playing it in VR.
Wow.
Yeah, that's
surprising.
I imagine they sold like 500,000 at least, right?
Yep, yep.
So that does seem like it's way more than I would expect.
That is interesting. Now, I picked up an eye tracker, and so I really want to see if I can get the eye tracker hooked up to a first-person shooter and see how that goes, because that might be the great middle ground for me between VR and between VR and not VR. Eye tracking in something like the Deus Ex game might be interesting. I'm looking at it more for programming and interface control, not playing games, but that might make an interesting video.
In gaming news, Valve has come under the scrutiny in the EU, and this is an interesting story. Now, if you're not familiar with the gray market in video games, it has to do with geo-locking. So based on what country you're in, video games cost different amounts of money.
Because some countries are poor.
Some countries are very poor.
Sorry, poor countries.
Eastern Europe in particular, poor countries.
We're well on our way there, though, poor countries. We'll be there soon.
I don't think they're ever going to discard our Valve games. But so what happens is a company doesn't assign an absolute value. The value of a video game is not $60 in these countries. They're willing to sell them for $20, $30, whatever they think that market will sustain, because it doesn't cost them anything. It's a digital copy. This goes back to what we were talking about before with the whole, you know, stealing the emails. So what happens is some enterprising individual buys up thousands of these keys in, you know, Poland or whatever, Czech, and sells them to the United States for this discounted price. And that's known as the gray market. So Valve, what they've done is region control. So you cannot in Britain, for example, you cannot register a Polish key. Britain's a bad example because they're about to be out of the EU. Let's say Switzerland. So in Switzerland, you can't register a Polish key because in Switzerland, that game costs more. Well, the EU, they're saying, hey, it's all one union. You can't do this here. It's got to cost what it costs.
Yeah. And so it's interesting because it's not just Valve that's also caught up in this. Asus and several other companies. And so
yeah, it's interesting that now you talk about digital, but with Asus, even hardware,
yeah,
they can make money selling it for far less in these poorer countries.
Yeah, but they don't want to undercut their market in somewhere else, lowering, quote unquote, lowering the price needlessly. So
it's needlessly.
It's like, hmm.
So it's interesting. People are usually pretty adamant one way or the other on the gray market thing. Some people think it's almost piracy, and some people are like, hey, whatever price I can get. So it's interesting that a lot of games have been region locked recently. You can't do that as much. But will they stop doing that if the EU rules against it?
Well, if globalization continues to be a thing, this is one way that globalization will benefit most people, is that everybody in the wealthier countries will be able to get their goods for less, and it will raise the economy in poorer countries because of the globalization. So
I don't think that's how they expect that to work.
No, well, they want the wealthier countries to continue to pay a higher price because it's a wealthier country, and that means that there's more margin involved. So But again, they want globalization for their own labor, but not globalization for finished products, which you can't have your cake and eat it too.
Or, you know, just simply don't sell them in countries where you can't make that same amount of money. But they're not willing to do that because you can make money at that margin.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, there's another lawsuit. Apple is having to defend itself against iOS 7 because apparently if you didn't upgrade to iOS 7, it would break FaceTime, which is Apple's built-in two-way voice or video chat thingy.
Now, this is Akamai. How do you pronounce that?
Akamai.
So Apple had a deal in the earlier versions with Akamai. They had a peer-to-peer sort of version of FaceTime, but if it couldn't establish that, it would go through Akamai as a relay. Well, in one of those hundreds of patent cases, they lost. And it was ruled that they had stolen the technology that they were using with Akamai. So the monthly cost for running that Akamai data service went from like tens of thousands of dollars to hundreds of millions of dollars. Because each FaceTime was paying a fine.
Wow.
So yeah, they in the latest version, they just simply made it not work because $100 million a month. And they're now being sued because these people are saying, hey, if I have an iPhone 4S, you've literally turned off one of the features you sold me. I can't use it. So you're forcing me to upgrade.
Classic Apple. But I don't know that this is really Apple's, you know, Apple being the bad guy here. Maybe Apple sort of throwing a tantrum, but it seems like they could negotiate a reasonable rate for the use of the patented technology.
Well, also seems like they could push an update that would, because they have a new method now.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So
for the older phones.
So what's stopping them from backdating and, you know, fixing the 4S to use this new, I don't know if it was like a hardware limitation, but it seems like they could work around it for $100 million a month.
A couple of developers could probably work on that, maybe. Probably that would come out okay. I don't know. Well, if you ever bought a graphics card that came bundled with a game and then you sold the game, that's not going to work anymore.
Yeah, this is similar to the gray market story. So it's pretty common. I've done this before. You buy, I don't even care about the bundled games. But we're going to give you like five games when you buy a brand new video card. They don't like the fact that those keys are being resold or even traded. So now they're going to be married to the hardware.
Yeah. I don't think I like this because.
Oh, definitely not.
It's like I'm going to buy the graphics card. And I wonder if, like, why would you do this? Does NVIDIA pay based on the activated copies of games? Because that's the only thing that makes sense.
Well, I'm pretty sure you can only activate them one time, no matter what. So.
But, like, it would be like buying a really high-end graphics card, and it's like, this comes with a free copy of GTA 5. Anybody that's going to be buying a $700 graphics card probably already has GTA 5 or doesn't care.
Maybe they don't like the idea that some of these are going to go to ATI cards.
That seems awfully petty of them. another sort of tech schadenfreude. LG's got this amazing new 5K monitor that is Thunderbolt, but it doesn't work when you're close to a router.
It turns out they didn't shield it. Can you imagine it's like, okay, what are the use cases for our end users? What living room? Might be around this monitor?
Only a Faraday cage.
Never tested it near routers. So it's what, 7 feet?
Yeah.
7 feet. If your router, now who doesn't have a router within 7 feet of their TV in their living room? That's got to be one of the most common. But this will freeze it up, cause it to shut down. Yeah. It has terrible, terrible impacts because of the shielding in this TV.
Yeah. So they have updated it, but LG is like, we did nothing wrong. And so it remains to be seen if they're going to start replacing these under warranty. I have a feeling that they will, and they seem to be making motions that they were going to replace these if people complained. But the first few hundred people to call in complaining that were told, no, we're not going to replace it because it's not a problem.
And imagine what a frustrating troubleshoot that was.
Yeah.
Oh, God, trying to figure out. It's your router that's killing your TV.
Yeah. It's like how many replacement TVs were sent to, you know, Joe Bob in upstate New York with his little villa. And it's like, oh, it works fine for a while. And sometimes it just completely craps out. I don't understand what's going on here.
Yeah, it's embarrassing.
Intermittent problems are some of the hardest to troubleshoot.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, robots are coming for your job. That's a common theme of this show. This is a robot barista.
It's amazing. Now, barista, coffee maker, for those of you who aren't hipsters, that's one of those jobs where it's like a sort of, it bleeds between like, you know, really low end and middle class. That's like in the middle. And there's a lot of those in America. We have, you know, we have a fixation on coffee. It's a big deal. They get paid probably a little bit better, definitely a little bit better than, like, you know, fast food, stuff like that. Probably a little bit better than retail. But this thing can do pretty much anything that a barista can do.
Yeah, it mechanically does anything that a barista can do. It's not like one of those, you know, one of those rest stop coffee machines where it's like, right. Oh, it's making coffee automatically. No, this is doing all the fancy stuff, frothing the milk, the whole nine yards. I mean, this is like an industrial robot with all of your standard issue really good coffee machines. So this is sort of a different tack on it.
So it's not like a Keurig machine, which is like, you know, it's trying to put it in one thing. The all the equipment stays the same.
Yeah.
It's just the human that gets replaced just by this arm.
This is going to be a trend now, for the next few years.
Here's my prediction. All right. So somebody get started on this. Starbucks, I'm going to give this to you for free. You go on your app, you upload a picture before you go to pick up your coffee. And when you get there, your froth is that picture.
This is the future that robots will bring.
It is good. I don't do the upscale coffee thing, but if this would save me a buck, I don't care. I'll drink robot coffee.
I could just imagine a Starbucks of the future. There's the complainer soccer mom lady in the soccer mom van. That's like, the robot made my kid look ridiculous. I want a refund. And it's like, is that really a thing? That's like the most first world problem ever.
I think they're going to have to put it behind a big sneeze guard, because there is that like small chance that it just throws coffee in somebody's face by accident. Can you imagine that lawsuit?
But it was like the seventh time you made the robot make your coffee. I don't understand.
It's got a counter. What was the settlement in the McDonald's lap like coffee?
Seven. Oh, I don't remember. It was, but the story in that one, that story was really interesting, because they apparently had been warned that they were running their coffee just shy of boiling, and so that was, there was more to the McDonald's coffee story than meets the eye. But yeah,
boiling water and robots.
Oh yeah,
risky.
That could be a dangerous situation. Yeah,
but I'm sure, you know, they'll have a little conveyor belt that brings it out to you.
Yeah,
totally solved.
Well, AI has decisively defeated human poker players now too.
And this is interesting. Now, of course, poker is a game of luck. I mean, there's clearly skill involved, but if you don't get the cards, you can't win. So they created a tournament just to figure this out. This robot played, or this AI played, 160,000 hands of No Limit Texas Hold'em. And it won an overwhelming amount of the time.
Wow. That's really surprising. For me, the interesting thing was the commentary from the really seasoned pro players. They were like, you know, the robot seemed to remember, you know, when it played against me and changed the way that it played. And so,
well, that was the hallmark of this AI. Like, they've made poker playing. I mean, of course, you know, you've played poker against an AI. There's all kinds of poker video games. This one learns.
Yeah.
And they were kind of worried about, like, well, if it can learn, can you sort of lead it down one path and then turn back on it and trick it? And these guys weren't able to.
Yeah. It was a really, really interesting exercise, because this is one of those hard problems in computer science that we don't think that software like this should be able to solve effectively, but it has, and at least so far. And so it's working really well. So until somebody finds a way to fight the machine, as it were, poker is basically a solved problem.
So don't go on these offshore betting sites and play poker against the AI.
They've probably bought the AI.
Yeah.
Well, can I license the AI so that I can release my own poker bot and make a whole bunch of money?
That would be a great, like, I don't know if you can make a TV show out of it, but like Robot Wars, except Poker Bot Wars. And, you know, instead of these like guys in visors and hoods and stuff sitting there, you've got like MIT teams sitting behind their robot.
Pretty sure that if an MIT grad student can make hundreds of thousands of dollars training in a poker playing AI robot, that they would probably do that instead of whatever the hell it is that they're doing as a grad student.
It could become sort of like NASCAR. You know what I mean? Like, the robot has sponsors and there's a team with, that could be entertaining.
I don't think that the, you know, 0.05% of the population that would really enjoy that could subsidize that alone, though.
Well, poker was big. What was it, like 2013, 2014? Poker was so huge.
It's true.
I don't know about robot poker.
Well, maybe if we dressed up the robots, like sort of anthropomorphized them and gave them a cowboy hat and some like over-the-top personality.
Give them, yeah, like sports teams, you know, give them an animal that represents wherever they are.
Like Terminator versus RoboCop in poker form, but the robots are just props. It's all just software behind the scenes. It'll be like wrestling, only with robots.
I might buy a t-shirt.
we're going to get Milk Raptor Labs started on that project immediately.
Milk Raptor Poker Bot. God, that's a dream.
Researchers build a detector that can diagnose at a breath, no doctor required, the flu.
This is amazing. This is a little bit dystopian, but I think it's great. I think every, like we're talking about the Super Bowl, they should just have these at the door. If you're patient zero, you got the flu, you have no business being at the Super Bowl, just turn you away at the door. You can't get into a movie theater. You can't get into a concert. Whatever it is, don't bring your flu germs to it.
But I feel fine. No, go home. You're contagious.
The breathalyzer doesn't lie. Now that opens up all kinds of abuse possibilities. But yeah.
The tickets are sold out and I got to get my girlfriend in. It's like, okay, I can run the door.
Imagine like, you know, at Foxconn. They'll have, you know, like those breathalyzers that are in your car. There'll be one in your apartment. It's like, I'm sick. Oh, yeah? Give me, blow into the thing and prove it.
So they can't take sick days,
you right, mean? Right, exactly.
Well, that's not a very happy note to end the news on. We need something that's funnier than that to end the news.
So we're going to bring in Krista for what we're gonna, failure by design.
Actually, failure by design.
This isn't much of a failure. This is just more of a...
we have to point and laugh.
Let's talk about some interesting design.
Hello, welcome back. We're doing a little design section today. I wanted to talk about, it's a dispensary in Portland called Sarah. They just did a big redesign, and they're trying to kind of upscale pot.
We haven't seen this.
Yeah, so...
This is a surprise for us.
This came up on one of the design blogs that I follow this week, and it's very, very trendy.
I don't think it's a terrible idea, because if you think about wine is no different than beer or liquor or, you know, Mad Dog, but it's got this mystique about it that makes it acceptable in higher classes. So I think that's what they're trying to do here.
I agree. I think I don't like this style personally, but I can recognize how it would be effective on the clientele they're probably trying to attract.
Oh God, guys, I just had a thought. We can't do this.
Why?
It's a reaction video.
Oh no.
Well, what's the clickbait title?
Yeah, what would the clickbait title be of this video?
You'll never believe something something level one text marijuana.
Something something. Pot. I mean, the all of the photography, there's literally a gold wrapped joint.
Well, let's
can
take
you scroll
a look.
Down? Yeah.
Switch to the.
There we go. Now they can see it.
Okay, so
this is the logo, which says nothing about who they are. Like the logo usually just says Sarah, like on the sign, which I always think that's a bad move. I think you should always have your like what you do somewhere in your signage, and their main signage does not have. We sell pot anywhere on it.
Purveyors of quality drugs. I mean, that's pretty...
That's not on their main signage, though. This is like their extended logo.
That makes me think of like cocaine in the context of 1899 cocaine.
Plus, yeah, that was what I got as well.
It's also very white, you know, which makes you think about...
Cocaine.
Yeah.
I can't... This blue is very popular right now in design, and I can't stand it because I grew up in the 90s and like early 2000s when like this bright blue was on every website because everyone had to use web safe colors. But now it's very, very trendy and I can't stand it. But that's a personal thing. That doesn't mean that it's not an effective project.
Still the color of links on Google.
It's RGB blue. The most blue you can get.
All right, what else we got?
Scroll down. You can see some of the... Their photography is actually really good. I will give them that. It's now, very, what, very nice.
This is in a legal state, though, right?
It is legal, yes.
Is that a prescription pad? What is the pad for?
I don't know. I think it's just to look cool. Like, it's kind of a waste of money, I think.
So it's like a fancy wine menu.
One of the things that they do, too, like a lot of branding agencies will put, like, the logo on a tote. And it's like, is it really a logo if you can't put it on a tote? Even if, like, the person they're branding would never use a tote bag.
Oh, it's labeled. It's the feelings. Okay. So you described your mood.
And then that's what you want.
And
yeah.
your pot barista.
Your pot barista
makes
tells
a
you
selection
what
you're... for you. This is wine. This is actually brilliant, the more I think about it.
Yeah, I know. My knee-jerk reaction was to not like it. But oh, the more I look at the thing, I do think there's some brilliance here, look, which I hate. But...
Is that a bong with a doily?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. This is why I waited to show them.
Oh, man, this is good.
I don't want to live on this planet anymore.
Scroll down, one of the pictures, the bong is almost $200 that they sell. It's just a plain white ceramic bong.
Oh, they've got their own rolling papers. I wonder what those cost. Do they have prices on this?
They do on their website. Not on this. This is the branding site that I read. They have a gold wrapped.
That's a gold blunt.
Snoop would be proud.
And matches, because you don't want to light your blunt with a lighter because
that's not classy enough.
The fumes from the lighter will spoil the taste.
My mental filing system has already automatically categorized this new information under things for people with more money than sense.
Yeah. That's, well, like when I went to their website too, because of course I had to look. And the bong alone was $200. And I was like, just why?
I'm not sure that this is terrible.
It looks like the filter on that joint is also gold. Is that the case?
I don't know. But the branding, I'd personally not for me, but I can see how like this would appeal to someone in Portland looking to like upscale their drug habit. I don't know.
Are these brownies?
I think just chocolate with pot in it.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
But why?
Look at this. It's cotton balls that they've like disassembled. That's actually really good photography, whoever did that. That's quite well done.
That is it's an impressive looking bong.
Is this a picture of your lung after?
I think that's the actual product.
Yeah, that's a
that's, I don't gram of weed. None of us do any drugs, so of course we're like, I don't know, what does a drug look like? Ryan, you should have watched enough prison documentaries. You should know.
That's a gram of weed.
I don't
get it. Oh yeah, this is the rotating.
Oh my god, is that like a holder?
That's what's on like the front of the website. Wow. Is that exact video clip? God,
you need like a monocle and a top hat to smoke that joint. That's incredible.
Some of the oils and stuff are like $75. Isn't weed the drug you go to like for cheap stuff?
Well, I think part of the legalization is they didn't want to change the prices because they wanted that to be like, you know, prohibitive for kids and stuff.
Yeah, that's the storefront. But see, looking at that, you would have no idea they sell drugs.
That's impressive.
Yeah.
This storefront looks astonishingly like something else that I'm not going to describe.
I think I would be going in there to get like furniture or something.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like, I felt like a little sad that they didn't try to pull some of the imagery from like traditional pot shops, like, you know, the beaded curtains and the, you know, the kind of cheesy stuff, but maybe try to upscale it. It feels like they just went with whatever's on trend right now.
No, I think they're trying to kill that. Oh, quality drugs. That's a nice.
Oh, and it, script, on the, yeah. on
the honeycomb thing?
Yeah, the antique honeycomb dowel tile.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Nice.
Yeah, I don't think they want any. I think this whole point is get away from like the hippie stoner vibe. It's not just about them anymore. Anybody can get into this high quality. Wow,
this high quality product.
Does it come in a box? Does it come in a wooden box?
I think it does. Yeah.
2 grams of weed and you get a wooden box.
And it's like $75.
That's incredible.
It's outrageous.
I really don't want to live on this planet anymore.
Is that weed called Tangerine Biscotti?
Yes.
Wow. they probably got a guy just coming up with names.
Like the color namer, but it says flavor namer. Post your favorite weed flavors in our comments below.
Don't do that.
Please don't do that.
Oh, it's black here. Or no, it's gold. It was black in the other.
I think it was just the shine.
Just the reflection.
Yeah. Oh,
okay.
I mean, it's a well-done identity. I just don't... I question like the departure from the history of pot shops, but I can see what they're doing, though, at the same time. Like, they have a living wall there. That's plants. With quality drugs embedded into it.
Are those pot plants? Because that would smell terrible.
I doubt that they... I don't know. How much pot can you grow in Oregon? I thought you could only have like a few plants.
I think if you run the shop...
No matter where you were.
If you run the shop, you can grow a lot.
I guess that makes sense.
There was something else I saw here that I was... Oh, yeah. The lighting. They've got designer lighting.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure this wasn't cheap.
But they look kind of like smoke rings.
Well, you notice too on the signage here, you can see that... It says, like, don't do any marijuana on the premises. They don't want you to do that there.
Because their clientele would have to be educated about such things.
Yeah. Who do you think works at these boutiques?
Oh, I bet it's, like, you know, ex-Starbucks employees.
I'm curious, like, would they go for the typical stoner, or would they try to get someone who was older and more mature? Like,
you probably need, like, a degree in communications or marketing to get a job
to get a job here. Yeah.
So is this a preview of what Apple's going to do with the iVape?
Yes.
I think they're looking for that same crowd.
This is, yeah, this is, they might team up with this place. Who knows?
there's probably going to be an app on your iPhone that communicates with your iVape and lets you order from this place.
It'll be good.
I just don't even.
This is the future, everybody.
We'll see you next week.
Bye.